Well, last week we do have like a social identity, you know, and I would try to bring a more like a talk about, you know, the gender, you know, we did go through some. And you missed the money and economy, Michael. Yeah. But I'm glad that today you come. We talk about, today we're going to talk about the environmental issue, and this is also, I think it's very the timing issue now. And you know, Michael sent me an email with a photo. Would you like to tell people about what's the photo about? The monk? Thailand. Thailand.
And they made an entire temple out of glass bottles that they like melted down and like reorganized. It was really impressive. And they were like living in it.
I was joking. I was joking. I hope those bottles are not wine bottles. Otherwise, those monks get drunk. I'm breathing. Yeah. Every time I go for a conference, sometimes I see people drink. Right? So people will ask me. I say, "Well, you drink. I got drunk." I say, "How come?" Well, because the food is not just consumed through, you know, your tongue. Will you believe it that we also consume the food through the nose too? Have you heard about this? You also take a medicine, not necessarily through your tongue, but through your nose. You just breathing in, that's it. So that's why I was joking with my colleagues. I say, "You drink, I get drunk." No, I don't think. Okay, good. Today we come to, hey, welcome, Eric. Come. Well, I think that we come to this what I call timing, a good topic about economy and ecology and the environmental issue. And I only print out a double side material for you. But let me tell you, I also posted, you know, I sent to Jeff right now in Australia, but about those article, and there was a good article, you should go to look at it. And you also can find that there was a website called Religion and Ecology, and those people who contribute the article on ecology and Buddhism by Donna Swale. He is the director at the Research Center of World Religion at Harvard, and very good article. I didn't print it for you, but it's all on the, you know, on the blog. Okay, my personal blog. You should go. You know, as I mentioned, if there was a long article, try to save the paper. I don't print for you, but you should, you know, get online and to look at it. And they also have some quotation from Buddhist sacred text, and they also have some like a project, you know, linking to the Buddhist very much they're aware of. So right now they even have the term called Green Buddhism. Like people are really a bunch of a Buddhist group. They really work on this environmental issue. And very interesting also, kind of up to this moment when every day talk about Buddhism and ecology, the Thai, what they call the forest monk, the Thai forest monk, those monks living in the forest, and they kind of try to bring the awareness about, you know, the, you know, extinction of the forest. And so it's, you know, whoever working on Buddhism and ecology kind of always have this awareness of what happened in Thailand. And this monk even developed a so-called ordination of a tree. They ordained the tree, okay? There were some rituals, and also have the article on that. So I did include that article, like a Rethinking Buddhism and Development, the Emergency of Environmentalist Monk in Thailand. So I hope that you will all go there to look at it if you are interested. As I mentioned, Buddhism and ecology, and also forest monk in Thailand. Basically, when you come to that, come to Buddhism and ecology. What I'm going to do today is, I will not introduce too much on those, the project, because you probably can get online and you can see what they were doing. But I think that, again, just like the nature of the class, I think I should introduce a very fundamental idea in Buddhism. What is the Buddhist, teaching or the doctrine can apply to what we talk about right now, the environmental issue. So there was, a few major teachings I would like to discuss with you, and then I hope that we can apply to that. Well, of course, here this is the first one. I say the three aspects of environmental issue: the toxic contamination of the food chain, and the worldwide consequences of nuclear proliferation, and the impact of global warming. And basically, when people talk about environmental issue, they kind of focus on food chain and nuclear proliferation, and also global warming. And this is kind of summarized from a few books when they come to talk about the environmental issue, different books and scholars. And also, this one I took from the website of the Forum on Religion and Ecology. There was Yale sponsored a big program on the environmental issue. So the professor who kind of in charge is Mary Tucker. She is a teaching at Yale, and then they developed so-called the Earth Charter. They have been working on this environmental issue for a long time. So today, as I mentioned, I'm not going through there, for the detail about, the crisis or the problems there. You probably can read a lot of article on that. But what will be the Buddhism? What kind of a Buddhist philosophy can kind of inspire us to see, this question? The first one, I think this the core teaching of Buddhism about interdependent origination. From the very beginning, when the Buddha attained the enlightenment, and if you ask what is really the Buddha realizing? What is his realization? He realized what? And you can tell from the Buddhist scripture, is this a theory called interdependent origination? And what he mean is that Buddha realized our human nature, or we say ordinary people, our nature, we tend to think that I'm who I am, and you are who you are. Especially in Western culture, we tend to think more like a individualism, okay, the self identity. However, though, from the very beginning, Buddhism was I think the Buddhism also give a big challenge to Western this philosophy about individualism, is because Buddhism talk about the non-self. And I think that we talk about that lot, last week. The first one is what is the non-self? Because when we come to the self, it means especially in philosophy content, the self is that it means okay, I'm the Eva, you are the Eric. Okay, I denied it. I'm Eva, you are Eric. No, that's not what it really means. It means the self in the philosophic content means okay, I believe like I have a permanent Eva, and I am independent. That's why I distinguish from you. That means I can take out all my the factors surrounding me. I still have that core of being an Eva. Okay, so it's kind of a permanent independent. and entity, just like an atom. You know, remember the Greek philosophy also tried to find what is the finest unit of the world. For example, material, they call atom. We want to find the core things, the substance, the entity. And then Buddhism basically said, well, there was no such thing. You can find, like, for example, being an ifa. The first one, you cannot say ifa never change. You know, like last week, we from the body, your physical body, we keep changing. That's why we become old. When you from the infant and become, toddler and then and a teenager and, youth and, middle age and now getting old. It's all keep changing. Even our cell, if you look at the detail, even in the cell in our body, every second, and the material, the atom, everything is changing. So Buddhist, the major of a Buddhist philosophy is a flux. So that's why the people say, well, Buddhism basically, it's the philosophy of what we call the flux. Okay, everything keep changing. And not only physical part, our psychological part, our sensation, our perception, our learning, our thinking, and our will, our volition. I want to do this, I want to eat, I want to drink, I want to, I need to go, and all the volition, and also our consciousness, even much faster. So from Buddhist view to analyze being a human being, being an individual, from physically, from psychological, there was no aspect that you can find you are permanent or not unchanged. Everything is changing. And and then you are not independent. For example, very, very clear. You say, okay, I'm an independent thinker. We always use that word, remember? But are you really an independent thinker? Probably very hard. Because even so, I say I'm independent thinker, maybe just only means, I can make a judgment by myself and I may be more critical. But it doesn't mean I won't affect by other people. I won't be influenced by other people. Who we are. For example, if now I make a statement about Obama, I never even touch Obama. I never even see him. How do I know who Obama is? I got from media. I don't even know who McCain is. We never met. How can I make a judgment about Obama? Well, I got from media too, reading. So really, if you think about, are you really thinking, independently? No. So this is what Buddhism see about, as a human being, and of course, it also kind of extended to all the other sentient beings as well. Okay, as a human being, we are really the kind of the product of the whole environment, all accumulation, all conditioned, product. We are not really can claim like we are totally independent. So that's why I call interdependent origination. Okay, interdependent origin. And not just a human being, but if you look at it, the table, the chair, and then, from Buddhist view, he tried to explain, of course, this is, and also, interdependent origination, and you also hear about sunyata, okay. Sunyata, emptiness. We tend to translate emptiness. Okay, emptiness. Well, emptiness, it doesn't really mean nothingness. Oh, there was nothing, or like a space. No, the emptiness, because it's all interdependent. Just like if you look at the camera, the tripod. If you took out one leg, then it crumb, okay, it fall. Because everything is like, they support each other. So when you take out the other one, And so that's why when the Buddha in the sutra tried to explain the emptiness, he said, oh, look at it. You know, I have a fist here, but when I open all the fingers, where is the fist? No, the condition. But I want to bring all the condition together. This is a fist. So if you take a, you know, the legs part, the table, and they won't have a desk. But when you put it together, so his idea is a, so what it go? It's called, on the arising of this, huh, that arise. This and right, this and that indeed are mutually independent. Huh. And on the cessation of this, that ceased. And so I think this idea is really kind of challenge the idea. Sometimes we think that okay, if I'm, you know, I win, you lose, and I can survive. Okay, or you know, I just think okay, we need to this culture, you know, this country become a super, you know, super power country. Then those people might be poor. Then they will challenge you. I mean, poor people sometimes they have their way to challenge you too. You know. So this is the idea about, you know, the this and that or arising. Indeed, it's all mutual in, you know, interdependent. Okay, dependence. Okay. So then, anyone has a question from here? Or okay, not. And then let me tell you also, the core teaching in Buddhism about interdependent origination, okay, is when you ask also what really the Buddha realized when he was sitting under the Bodhi tree. Bodhi tree is all to do with the tree. What is really the philosophy, the value, or the reality he realized? And very clear in the sutra is that he realized interdependent origination. And then the Buddha started to teach it, what is it, the so-called the 12 links. And I would like to invite you to see the what is the 12. But the first one, I think if I want to explain this 12 link, maybe from the back. Remember there was one time when I talk about mind and life? I said, well, we all afraid to, you know, to die. Why we will die? Will we get old? Even though you are very healthy, but everybody will get old and die. So far right now, nobody's here. In the history, nobody can avoid, right? Even the Chinese emperor tried to find all the longevity, and then, you know, Western as well, and even right now, they have frozen the body and try to still keep this longevity. But so far, we all know this death, it's inevitable. We are all mortal. And so, but I ask why we will die. Well, we get old, we get, you know, we got sick. And why we get old? Well, when you're 60, 50, 40, 20, 10, you're an infant, because we are born, because of birth. So that's why we will be dead. So it's the birth leading to death. Yeah. So indeed, every day, I don't want to scare you, but when you think about it, every day indeed we are two words closer to that goal, to the destination. And if you think about it, well, you know, probably you don't think about it, life is much better. But if you think about it, every second, indeed we are two words that destination. Well, okay, the Buddhism talk about, okay, the birth, how come you have a birth? It say, well, it's not just something come out from nothing. Okay, so it's a come out from becoming. The becoming also conditioned by clinging, and clinging conditioned by craving, and craving by the sensation and contact. Okay, here, how can we understand this is so-called the birth and becoming? For example, what you want to own, for example, if you like to own a car, For example, you see some, oh, the new SUV. Maybe it's a you know, I always use a car as an example because everyone, most people love car. I realized that, have you ever kind of a, well, do you want to guess what is the most advertisement on the TV? Car. Car is the I believe it's the, ever you know, the highest rate advertisement on TV. Maybe you, next time you pay attention and you come back to tell me. I think it's the car. And so, well, okay, I use car. So for example, you see someone has a car. Maybe, you know, what is it? BMW SUV. And you like it. Okay, you like it. What are you going to do? Oh, it's especially our kids, am I right? They see their friend driving sports car. What they going to do? Okay, I'm going to prepare the money. I try to get the money anyway. I want to get it. Okay, from here, I just explain here. How do we get things? Well, the first one is through our eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, our all sensory organs. And when we contact with the outside world, get the information, and we develop this like it or dislike. So the sensation, remember contact, through the six organ. Okay, six organ. And then the contact is just not this contact. When I see that picture, it's the contact. When I hear, when you hear what I'm saying, that's the contact. So through this sensory organ, we got the contact, got the information. And then we develop what? Pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral. When something pleasant, you know, like, oh, I see, you know, the picture, oh, you know, that painting is very beautiful, I like it. Or you see someone, oh, very beautiful, very handsome, you know, I like it. So that's the, when something pleasant, we develop what? Attachment, and, or what we call like. And when you keep doing it, like you eat something good, you want to go back to that restaurant. Indeed, I went back to a Mexican restaurant in Chicago twice. This time, and then because of my friend, you know, he said, oh, Eva, this is my second time because I came here yesterday, so I bring you. So then the next day, I bring another friend. And the friend said, he's from Japan, he said, oh, next time I come to Chicago, I want to remember here. I will come back here. You know, look at it. We all have this sensation, pleasant sensation. And now we become attachment. That's good because I don't live in Chicago. So I will not go to that restaurant all the time. But we did go to some of the restaurants almost every week. Okay. So that is, you know what? When we have something we like and then we develop attachment. How about when you something unpleasant sensation, then we develop this dislike. And then what? We may get rid of it. I don't like it. Get rid of it. I think that's a hatred. That's a war. Where did war come from? So sensation develop this. How about you say, well, neutral is better. Maybe, you know, neither pleasant nor unpleasant. No, from Buddhist view, that's not good either. Because sometimes, you know, a lot of people, as I mentioned, you know, they are in depression. It doesn't matter. Okay. Oh, let's go to take a walk. No. Nothing make them feel like excited. Because they kind of lose the pleasant or unpleasant, they tell you. So in Buddhism, when you say indifference, sometimes may not be too good either. So that's the sensation part. Well, you focus on this craving. Like when you develop attachment, you like it. Through your sensation, you feel pleasant, you like it. Then you like craving. Okay, I want to have that car. I want to have that SUV. And then you what? You lead into it, cling into it. You know? So this, in here, Chinese will say, 触受爱取有. So you're kind of clinging. Then you lead in, of course, everybody's always try to what we call the follow, you know. Mostly we follow what? Our sensor pleasure. We all want to see beautiful things, want to hear nice music, we want to, you know, taste good food, smell something. But it could be a very subjective. Because for me, it could be good, but for you, it may not be. For me, very pleasant, like a rock and roll. Frankly, until now, I still cannot appreciate rock and roll. I don't know how to appreciate it. I have to admit it, sorry. Yeah. So it could be very, you know, subjective, but we all, you know, leading to that. So look at it, it's in our everyday, in every moment, our thought, our action, it's a chain. It's a chain reaction. It's not just something happened. Okay. And well, okay, here, then I were, you know, then what do you say, name and form? What are you talking about, Eva? Name and form. Remember, I told you the name in Buddhism is called Ming Shi. Indeed means what? The form is a physical part, but the name, literally name, it means a psychological part. So here, okay, well, if you allowed me, remember when we talk about mind and life or dying, living and dying? We would talk about what is the beginning of a life? What is the moment of life? Well, in Buddhism, it believe it starts from where? It starts from the moment of a conception. So when the father's you know, sperm and the egg, when they join at that moment, it's what we call fertilized egg. That's the physical part for a human being. And that's here, so-called the form. And the name part, it's the psychological part. Indeed, it's so-called nama-rupa. Nama and the rupa. And rupa means, here, Chinese, ming and si. And rupa means a form. And the nama, well, literally means a name. But this part is the physical part. And this part is the psychological part. And remember when we talk about living and dying, this part is the Buddhism talk about the alaya consciousness. Remember, the intermediate existence are looking for. Like after we die, okay, the body live here, but our consciousness are looking for somewhere to be. So when you find the condition is there, then you, when the consciousness join this fertilized egg, that's the time when name and form join. Okay. Well, this join was driven by the consciousness. And it was driven by the volition. Usually it's your karma. And karma, we also call karmic force. So from Buddhist view, that even when we die, indeed, you know, our karma accumulated. Have, you know, this consciousness is kind of like driven by a force. The consciousness is like a karmic force. And it will be driven to somewhere whenever you will be reborn. And you say, okay, I want to be reborn in a very rich family. I hope so. You know? Because when it's driven, it doesn't mean, okay, you really chose. It was by the nature of your karmic force. Right. And this one, but of course here, so volition, how about ignorance? Because from Buddhist view that if you already attained the enlightenment and realization, you are not driven by the ignorance. Remember I told you ignorance, it didn't mean like you are not smart. But it means you are not intelligent. Intelligent people still have ignorance. The ignorance is someone who doesn't know about the reality. So mostly we are very, very intelligent people, but we still have that ignorance. Ignorance, you don't know what is the meaning of existence. We tend to be always try to grasp existence. So the ignorance have that tendency to grasp, to catch the existence. So do you know what? Remember the Buddha was encounter the aged people, the old people, the sick people, and dead people. So he was starting to think about why we have all this suffering. You know, of course, I mean, Taoism is, well, because we have this body, so we have suffering. And because we have this body, we have to eat. We need the food, and we need to drive. And that's why we need the oil. You know, we need the gasoline, and that's why we have to fight. We have to occupy the land, because we want to live, we want a house, you know. And so this is what is really the cause of the suffering. It's because we have this body, and then we also have our mind. And so the Buddha was saying, okay, this is that we are living in this chain, this kind of a flow, like a chain by chain. It's all interconnected. So Buddhism about in interdependent origination basically try to explain that this whole world is the cause and effect. It's all connected together. But also, when you come to this point, sometimes you will think kind of in a linear way of thinking. Okay, cause and effect. Okay, only. Oh, okay, this is the cause, and then this is the effect. Everything is like one line. But that's not really what Buddhism means. Buddhism means, okay, even though I'm talking about cause and effect, and maybe condition here, and, retribution here, okay. Even though you say, okay, cause A leading to B, effect, even, you know, we can say that, but indeed, when it's happened, it occurred, it doesn't just one living to be. There were many, many things, like at the same time, multi-dimension. So Buddhism see this world, later we'll come to the cosmology idea about, the Buddhism read about the world, it's not just say, okay, one dimension. It's all dimension. Okay, now let's come to see the other philosophy about this interdependent origination come to what we call Mahayana Buddhism. It's basically from so-called the Hua Yan, in Chinese called Hua Yan, or the Avatarsangha Sutra. Sometimes you find people translate just called Garland Sutra. It's a big, big sutra. Okay. Garland Sutra in Chinese, in English they translate Garland Sutra by Avatarsangha Sutra. It basically literally means a flower adornment sutra. And in this sutra, it describes the Buddhist cosmology. And it said, well, the whole world is not just one dimension and not two dimension, but multi-dimension. It's kind of infinite. Okay, and I think that very interesting right now with more astrology, we realize the world, it's indeed not just what we were thinking about in the past, like only Earth, or just Earth and the Sun and Moon. Now more galaxy. And we couldn't find even the border of the end of the universe yet. And so in the Garland Sutra, it mentioned, it tried to describe that the whole world, if you look at the whole world, but it also referred, it said, okay, a lot of things in the sutra, the idea is very challenging. So you know, in the past, the people think, oh, you are crazy, you know. What does the sutra mean? It doesn't make sense. For example, it mentioned about the mountain Sumeru, okay? The mount. Mount Sumeru. Sumeru in Buddhism is considered the center mountain of the world. So when you come to the mountain Sumeru in Buddhism, Xuminsan, huh? The idea is it's the center of the world, but it's the mountain. Well, he said, and then the other one contract is called like a sesame seed or mustard seed sesame. Okay, let's use a sesame, okay. Sesame? Oh, sesame. Okay. When you get cross, always. Okay. So, well, this we know mountain is a big. Or sesame is a small. Or sand. You can see the sand. Well, logically, well, you said, 那个, 虚弥, it can embrace all the sand or all can embrace contain the sand. But on the other hand, he also said that the 戒指 also not 虚弥. The a sesame or a mustard seed also embrace the mountain 虚弥路. Of course, I mean, if from mathematic logic, it doesn't make sense, right? For example, I say, oh, okay, you know, this house can contain the people. But if I say, well, no, I mean, the people also contain or embrace the house, you say, how come? You know, if you say, Ifa embrace, you know, contain this house, you say, how come? The house is bigger. So in the ancient time, in the sutra, it says, 虚弥那戒指, 戒指那虚弥. Literally means, okay, the mountain embraced the sand. And it's also a sand, a grain of sand contained the whole mountain. Well, then, you know, the scholars say, well, I mean, the scholars say, well, Buddhism doesn't make sense. You know, only big can contain the small. How can small contain the big? So then in the past, then, you know what, then the Zen master will ask the scholar say, okay, how much books you have read, you know, scholar? He said, in Chinese we have a 5 cart, you know, like a cow, ox cart. That means a lot, 学富五集, a lot of cart, or library. You say, okay, I read a lot, 1,000 books. And then Zen master would then ask you, say, oh, okay, where did you store all this knowledge of 1,000 books in your brain? Your brain is so small. Where did you store this memory? You know? And right now, I think that with the computer, how much information you can print out from two gigabyte GB. How much pages you can print out? 1,000, more than that. So I mean, this idea is kind of breakthrough. This while we try to have like a physical, we always tend to be kind of try to see the concrete. But I mean, it's beyond. Beyond logic and beyond this, we try to be, you know, kind of locality. It's beyond, we always think about big and small, and one and many. So in Buddhism, say, oh, one is many, and many is one. Or oh, big is small, and small is one. Right now, if you have USB, that your chip, 2 gigabyte, you know, USB. How many information you can put there? A lot. If your computer, you know. So the idea, like really beyond these contracts, big and small, many and one, it's already in this, you know, what we call the Avantasaka Sutra. Well, any question here? Anyone has a question? Is that understandable? And what I'm trying to say, or is what you say, whatever you said. Okay. Is that clear? Sure? Okay. Okay, let's move to the intranet. Well, this is also the idea about the intranet. I was talking about it's more like an internet. And indeed, there were some people already used this name, intranet, as their company name for internet already. Well, intranet is the name of a god, the deity in Buddhism. Okay, he's kind of, you know, major in charge. He's you know, the territory. Well, they just use this name, and the jewel net of the intro. Well, it described that, you know, the whole world. If you think about it, there was a spider net, okay, spider net, and then on each of these spider net, there was a knot. I don't know. Maybe. I'm not sure. Is that really? I don't think they really do that, but I. Okay, and then you have all these nets. Now you have to use the imagination. It's a spider net. I'm not sure they really are. Or tango, but do you think the spider really very I Ching? Chinese? Okay, if you think about it, you know, this is the net. And then he said, well, on the knot of this net, there was jewel. Okay, here. On the each knot, they always have this jewel. And remember, this jewel are three dimension. Indeed, he said multi-dimension. Okay, and more. Yeah, more. More, too. Uh-huh. Well, if you think about it, on this is the jewel. For example, we took out this one. The jewel on the surface are like a mirror, this one. What kind of image you will see? What kind of image on this surface you will see? Well, you probably see the reflection from this one, from that one, from that one, from this one, from this one, from this one. Huh? However, though, since the reflection on here, do you think that this one will reflect here too? Yes. So, you already reflect on this one. And then your image in this one will flash back. And then here, and then you have its image, you also reflect back there. So if you see the image, you will become what? Infinite. Infinity. And it's not just one angle, it's all dimension. So in Buddhism, talk about each of us like the jewel on this knot, on this net. We are indeed the reflection of our whole environment. For example, if you ask who are you, can you really independent from your family? Probably not. Right now we talk about lots about Obama. We talk about lots about McCain, the whole life story. It's not who we are. It's really, you know what, your family education, your school education, your friend association, right now your career and your nationality, where you are. It's really the all accumulation become who we are. And not only that, you also put your influence on other people too. Don't just think, oh, you know, I'm an ordinary people. I'm a tiny one. I'm a nameless. But really, I mean, you can affect your friend. You can affect. You have an influence your friend. You have an effect on your family. And so this is the way the Buddhism talk about that who we are. If you asked about the meaning of existence. You are the jewel on the net. And who you are, because you are influenced by all your surrounding, and you also have the effect on other people as well. Okay, and not only that, not just you as a human being, but all the sentient being as well. So it's a, you know, human and animal, and animal and human, and human and the nature as well. So this is the Buddhist idea, multi-dimensional world. And then beyond this one and many and one, or the big and small. It's beyond that. And that's what Buddhism talk about, the reality. And that is also when you read the Heart Sutra, you say, okay, no eye, no ears, no tongue, no body, no mind. And then you even say, okay, indeed there was no color, no sense, no no smell, no thought, no taste, no thought. It's when you say no, it didn't mean they are not. It just say, okay, don't stick to it. You grasp, think it's a reality. It's beyond. It's beyond just what you see. If I say, okay, this is the table, and from Buddhist view, say, hey, come on, don't grasp it. Think that this is a real table. Because once when I tear apart, there was no table here. It's just a provision, visionary. It's there. It's a temporary existence. So when the Heart Sutra say no, or even he say, no ignorance, no aging, no death. He said, well, beyond that. And so what happened? Well, let me tell you what really Buddhism, what we can learn from Buddhism is, in our daily life, we always think that what we see, what we hear, what we think, what we touch, we grasp so real. Okay. But in Buddhism say, that's not really the reality. You got to be beyond it. You didn't realize that you think, okay, I am who I am. I'm independent. But in Buddhism, the reality is you cannot be just yourself. You are who you are is because you are the all accumulation or all the reflection consists of who you are. And this is a reality. Okay. A lot of things... remember I always use this idea about, okay, we think that we can see. Okay, only through seeing, then I believe. Remember, we always say that. But even you don't see it, it's there. Like your cellular phone wave, but the low frequency and the high frequency sound, or the long wave, a short wave. Do you know how many things are in this space? It's not just what you see. There was a lot of things you cannot see, but it's here. And maybe include a lot of, a battery, a germ, right, in the air as well. But you cannot deny it. But we always grasp, only I can tell, then I admit it's there. Or this is the way I see, but it's not really the reality. So I think that the learning of Buddhism, it's at least, we also, okay, it's good. The breakthrough our delusion. We have lots of delusion or illusion as well, But the Buddhism is, especially Heart Sutra, no. It say, well, break through your delusion. That's not really the reality. So, and so, sometimes we find, okay, so whenever we do something, and that's what brings the Buddhism about the awareness. For example, you cut down a tree, you just say, oh, good, I cut down the tree, I make a lot of chopstick, I make a lot of wood furniture. We are not aware of what it could be a reality is. And so... That's from Buddhist way. I would like to have someone kind of read about, who would like to read this, Jewel Net of Indra, this quotation. It was described by Francis Cook, in he was talking about the Avantasaka Sutra. Anyone want to read this, the, on this paragraph? Michael? Read it.
Okay.
Oh, what? Oh, you have a question?
No, you didn't ask me.
Okay, so this is, and you know what, on the, could you read the kind of a parenthesis, I read it? This is a report, a National Academy of Science report. He said, our world. So, you know, the whole world, it's a interdependent, especially right now when we talk about global warming, you know. I think there was a lot of things, you know, you probably see old article about global warming, how, you know, the food chain, the reaction. You know. So, but the idea, the philosophy, it's already in the Buddhism. And the other thing is, okay, so Buddhism talk about, right now everybody's all talk about the global warming. Now we talk about the energy things. You heard from this presidential talk about energy policy, you know, we have to develop. But very interesting though, everybody still focus on the, you know, I mean, this world, the physical world we live, but never go to the real, the sources. What is the real problem of this, energy crisis? What is the real causes of energy crisis? What do you think? Huh? Our need. What do you think, how big is our need? How much food you eat? How much food we eat? When you go to the restaurant, especially in the United States. Am I right? We go to a restaurant. A lot of time, we indeed take the need, we order more than what we need. Look at the Starbucks coffee, so big, the cup. I mean, you never see the cup so big before. I mean, frankly, I mean, the 20 years ago, I came to the first time I came to the United States, I never see there was the cup this big, or Coca-Cola. It was just recent years. Yeah, the popcorn, it's crazy. Like it's a basket. But that wasn't happening before. And the house is bigger and bigger, but how many people live there? Usually it's one. And the funny thing I will find, after when the kids are still living in the room, the house was small. But after all the kids move out, only the couple, then the house become bigger. And I always feel like, and not only that, have you seen about some report, how many percentage of people in United States, they have more than one house? And what they were doing is they, since they have money, Okay, so they just hire a maid and then have a whole year air conditioning running there. And they just go there maybe, you know, 1 month or a year. And sometimes I always wonder why you need so big house. And the energy. I really the energy. So I think that, you know, very interesting when we come to the ecology. And I like to talk about, I think that we need to have a mental ecology. This is the way I want to say. I think that the reason we, I always say, okay, our action, our words is the product of our mind. When you say something, when you do something, it's because of what's inside your mind. And then I think the whole world were created by our mind as well. The architect by our mind as well. So that's why Buddhism, the Yogacara say, well, 三界为心，万法为事. All the phenomena, nothing else, but it's the reflection, the manifestation of our consciousness. And you even can say, you know, who created this world? It's we, our mind created this world. And now we have a crisis. Why we have a crisis? It's our mind create this old crisis. And so when we deal with the environmental issue, I think, well, I mean, if we come out with a good policy, we can get energy. But if it, you know, we use such a way, wasteful. I mean, you can never enough energy. If our greed become a deep. So, I mean, so here I give you the poisonous root in Buddhism. Oh, it's about greed, hatred, and the ignorance. Greed. I mean, we try. We want the house bigger. We want the car bigger. We want to, you know, we really consume a lot of energy. Our body doesn't need that much, you know. So. Like we go to restaurant, you know, the food is always a lot and big. Well, hatred. When you come here, talk about the nuclear proliferation, the war against someone we don't like, or competition. I think there was another one is the fear, insecure. You know, I think this insecure and unsatisfactoriness is really, you know, bring the suffering, you know, to our life. And this is all from the what we call the ignorance. So from here, you know, I think that that's the reason when everybody talk about the environmental issue. And I know, you know, global warming and plant the tree and doing everything. Yeah, I think that we should support and we should be aware about whenever we cut in the tree, and maybe we should not only not cut in the tree, plant more tree, maybe not just that. I think that also I think our, you know, spiritual, not just material, but spiritual environment as well. So, when everyone is working on that, of course, I mean, those are environmental issues, you know, talk about the you know, the food chain, or the, about the climate, it's, you know, I myself, I'm not the expert on that, but, you know, when I write, so I came up with this book, it's more kind of try to analyze, it's not just material. We have a material junk, but we also have a lot of a spiritual junk too. And I think that to you know, solve the problem of the crisis on the earth, we also have to look at human mind as well. So I remember when I told you about, like, you know, the president of the, you know, General Assembly at the UN. He just come out, he mentioned, you know what, he have heard about, he deal with this international, you know, politics. And when he came out to say it, finally he just said a very simple word. He said, I think the problem, we have the problem in this world is selfish. It's the selfish create this conflict. And if you know what happened recently, on the Wall Street, the collapse. I mean, usually you don't see that word when the things are getting good, you know, you never hear that one. But have you picked up the word? They say greed. Greed is the cause for, you know, the collapse of on the Wall Street, our economy. So then, you know, very interesting, you'll come back to see that you come back to what Buddhism kind of pointed out, the moral issue. Moral issue too, okay. So you know, in my book, I just I'm not trying to promote this one, but I think this is a good material when we talk about the environmental issue. Well, I mean, for example, food have a lot of junk food. I think that if you look at it, your body as you know, from Buddhist view, that our own body it's kind of a small cosmos as well. So, you know, how do you treat your, this is a tiny cosmos. It's also you have to be aware what kind of food you eat and how you eat it. So 2 weeks ago, the weekend, we were have up there at the park. You guys like the guotang, the eating with the silence? You know, well, basically it was emphasized like eating with mindfulness, you know. I think there was we can learn from a Buddhism a lot of things from the practice. What I mean, you know, this just eating with the silence and take whatever you need. Indeed, what happened is, you know, the cook told me, he said, "Oh, if I know about that you're going to guotang, I will cook less food." So that means the guotang really consume less food. But when it's a buffet, it consumes a lot of food. And when we have all the buffet, and then we put a lot of food there, and then we go to the fitting center and to exercise and try to get our more, you know, fat. You know? I don't know, we just have all these cycle things, you know, vicious circle, you know. But anyway, and not just the food, but also, you know, staff. They, you know, one time the Master Xing Yun said, if in your life, at least you should have one time just get rid of everything and see. And I always find that, you know, very interesting in Fo Guangshan, all the monks and nuns have to transfer, huh? You from this temple to that temple. And every time, I find very funny, it's, you know, every time you buy something home, you always can find somewhere to put your stuff. Drawer, closet, on the table. But when you are moving, suddenly you realize that your stuff is a multiply. You don't have enough box to carry all this stuff. So I think that sometimes you should, you know, we have this practice. Every time we were shipped, you know, to another place, and we have to pack everything and then go to the other place. So every time when you pack, then you remind, oh, okay, I don't need a lot, too many things. It's become a burden. So I don't know, I mean, maybe that would be good for you guys to move, you know, like wandering monks and nuns, and every time, and you also find like you don't need that much. Like, when I travel a lot, and when I go out, I travel for 3 months, I still have the luggage half, just my stuff, and the other 1.5 or half, it's all books, it's all temple stuff. You know. Really, I think that we really don't need that much. If you go home, maybe you look at your closet and really look at it. And also look at how many things you don't need it. I don't know, very interesting for me. Every time I go to the department store, I look at all the clothing there and the stuff, the mass production, you know, a product there. And I was wondering, I say, I mean, I don't believe that everyone is going to buy all this. But where did they go? Michael, can you tell me where did they go? Those clothes, if out of season or... And the food, huh?
Thrift stores, maybe?
Huh?
Thrift stores. Secondhand stores.
But they still consume all this stuff? Same to other country. How about those food expired? Outlet. Near Deer Park. But there's still a lot of stuff too. I think that we need to have that documentary to see where the clothes come from, where did they go. And the food, how about all those, you know, expired food? Where did it go? Don't you think that's a kind of waste? Like you put all the energy to all the product, and then later you never use it, and just put it there. And nobody does feel like have a bad conscience? You know what? You know, sometimes I buy something and it expires, and then I have to throw away, and then I would look at the bottle, and I think I have a funeral for the food. And really, I just say, oh, I'm so sorry, like you came to this earth. And then, you know, I mean, make no use. And then you kind of, you were born, and then you know, I just have to throw you away. Yeah, it's really a funeral. You know, for those things, the food you didn't eat, you know, like expire, you know, yogurt, your yogurt is, and I said, oh, too bad, you know, the you know, the cup, the yogurt inside, you know, I have to see like all the labor, you know, go through this product. Yeah. And said, so this one, you know, you didn't eat it or you never use, and now I have to throw away, and then, like you said, go to the earth. I just feel like this one came, kind of waste the whole life, you know. So we need to have a funeral for this, you know, waste of food, too.
For a really good, like, 10-minute documentary thing?
Yes.
The story of stuff?
The story of stuff? Yeah. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Well,
I was thinking that we have an ordination for a tree. Maybe we should have a funeral for all this waste of food. It just keep your awareness about you know, every time when we waste, you know, a kind of stuff. Or even a cloth. You know, I never have the clothes I never wear. And indeed, we always have, usually, you know, like this robe we wear for, you know, more than 20, sometimes, I have a robe, it was more than 17 years. And what happened, it was still okay, but it just because, you know, what do you call it, the trim kind of become loose. So I go to the tailor, the Korean, you know, cleaner tailor. I said, could you fix that for me? And then I just trust them. But it ends up, they just cut off my so I can no longer, I would say, oh, 17 years, yeah. History, yeah. I know, maybe kids need to give it to kids, yeah. But I don't know, it was bad. But usually, you know, I mean, all our clothes are definitely more than 10 years. And not only more than 10 years, usually is. I think this one indeed is 10 years old now. You know, in 1999, when I was in Taiwan. So, so, and also we wear almost every day. Of course, this is a winter season, but, you know, we only have like a two to replace, you know, season. Yeah, this is a winter, and they also have the summer. So we make a good use of it. We make a good use of it.
marketing and advertising that people are trying to sell. So it's a huge force.
I know. Yeah, but you know what? This is it. Yeah, exactly.
If
that's why.
If people didn't participate or people didn't participate or fall prey to it, then it wouldn't work. But because of, you know, ignorance, greed, all these things.
Yeah.
People participate.
You know, when you walk, especially walk in New York, you probably find a lot of a delusion. Like you see all the signs about like a young men, young women wear, you know, underwear or, you know, like a perfume or things. I think this is really a delusion. The first one is even those people look good, but the clothes you put on your body, you don't look like a celebrity either. You don't look like a model either. So I think there was a lot of a delusion about it. And the other thing is, of course, I mean, you know, those advertisement that looks like, you know, of course, that's the people. I think there was a bunch of professionals. They create a lot of delusionary worlds for us. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. And not only that, well, sometimes I feel like, you know, sometimes I'm confused about this, you know, people always say, okay, I would like to be individual, you know, this individualism, but you also have a so-called fashion, you know. You have to wear, okay, right now this is the fashionable, everybody will wear this one. And I just don't know, where is the individualism here? You know, everybody want to be the same, you know, so. Oh yeah, sometimes, yeah, you're right. Yeah, you made it. I don't know. I think that you know, so you know, kind of a come back to, you know, that we really live in a very, you know, not really, you know, fixed reality. And we are, at the same time, we are affected by the outside world as well, you know.
Uh-huh. So, you know, you might want to throw away certain things associated with a prior experience, and you want to have that memory or that reminder. So that's another reason why people find it hard to throw away things.
Yeah.
And in my home, I have an non-working radio because my husband's brother.
Yeah, a lot of things. But you know what, sometimes you find like, you know, it's very hard in our life sometimes to move on because you really don't know whether you can live without this. But a lot of time it's better for you to live without this. You know, very funny. I mean, it's hard to just telling you. I think that you got to try. And I myself, I feel like I live in a life, always move on. And I find I'm much healthier. You know, for example, you attach to certain thing or you attach to a certain people. Okay, maybe your children, maybe someone you love, maybe your parents. You at that time you would say, oh, I probably cannot live without him or her or them. But very interesting, once when you move on, you just realize, you know, you turn it back, you see, wow, you know, I mean, now you are much healthy, you know, with a life of move on. You know? So everything, again, it's here. It's in the mind. I don't know how, you know, for example, I always try to tell people, especially if, you know, someone you love dies suddenly, you know, or something happened. And we spend a lot of time to reject the reality, the factor here. So we struggle. But I find that if you can train yourself, just say, hey, okay, I accept it. This is the things I have to accept. My life got to move on. I think that would be much healthier. You know? It's just because you cannot change the fact. For example, someone you love died. You know, I would just mention about the husband, 40 years old, and 3 days he went to the hospital to check, and he was okay, but he was too busy for a whole month. And then, you know, suddenly he died at that moment. So I always kind of put myself in the wife, you know, his wife. Say, how can his wife move on? You know, the first thing is you got to accept, okay, this is to happen now, and I got to move. You know, and I find, you know, from my you know, being a nun, I kind of have a consultation with the people. I find that the suffering is because of people clinging to the past. You don't want to recognize, you don't want to say, okay, this is it, move on. You don't want to waste your energy here, clinging to the past, but it's just life and move on. And sometimes you find not only healthy, and that's even sometimes even, you know, have a more chance to open up, really. So I think I try to mention about the mental ecology. When we talk about the environmental issue, our world, I think that if we have a healthy mind, then you can create the healthy environment for you. When you go to look at all the book, talk about positive attitude, you know how to manage your emotion. Indeed, that's all, you know, about how can you have a healthy insight. And so in my book, I kind of want to continue that. You know, when I talk about the you know, junk stuff, I also have a so-called junk communication. Yeah, we got a lot of spam, you know, junk mail. And not only that, you know, some people cannot live without cellular phone. Some people cannot live without get on, you know, the computer. I told right now that everybody's life is the first day. Before your eyes open, the first thing you have to turn on the computer and check out your email. And even when your eyes are already closed, you're really tired, right? You fall asleep, but you still don't want to turn off your email. So this is kind of the not very healthy, I have to say, not very healthy. So communication, you know, again, like I say, you know, I love, you know, technology thing, but, you know, we got to remember we need to become the master of the technology, not become the slave of the technology. And definitely, like an iPod is beautiful, iPhone, everything I enjoy. But the most important thing is you want to master, you want to make a use of them, but you don't want to become the use of you. So we were joking about, yesterday we have a scholar, we were talking about, like in Hong Kong, he teach in Hong Kong because the road is very steep, so he would try to ride a bike. So he said, wow, it's so steep, you cannot even, you know, hit the brake. So I said, what did you do? He said, oh, I have to carry the bike. I said, okay, now who's the rider? Who? Oh my God. Is the bike ride on you or you ride on the bike? Okay, so this is like a gong an, the kong an, you know, the Zen kong an. It's who rides who? Is you ride the bike or the bike rides on you? You know, again, I mean, in our life, it's you use the machine or machine use you. You know, who's become the master, you know, of these things? And relationship again. They might have lots of junk relationship. Anyway, the bad, negative relationship, you know, unhealthy relationship, it's all junk relationship. And sometimes we can be more selective. And final chapter, I was talking about the emotional, junk emotion and junk thought. And came back here, it's a greed, hatred, and ignorance. And if you move to Mahayana Buddhism, I think there was a very beautiful, the last one, when we talk about Tathagata, or when we talk about Bodhisattva vow, that would be next week. You know, you know, when you move on to the Buddhism, when it says, where is all my money? Where is all my wealth? Where is all the treasure? It's here. And really, I know I was have a conversation with my my student about it. You know, right now everybody try to, you know, ask you for the money, and I remember, you know, they, of course there was a context. I say, hey, you know what? I said, Jason, do you know where is the money? Money is here. I think it's your idea, your brain, your mind. You can create a fortune. You don't really ask for the cash. It's your mind can create a fortune. And so what I mean is really it's really the wealth is inside. And of course Buddhism, especially Mahayana Buddhism, would like to leave you to understand what the, you know, the infinite treasure is here inside. So when you talk about, you know, you're talking about this the advertisement, the products, sometimes we try to buy things so we can get recognized. Again, you know, I don't know what we talk about individually. Indeed, we were so much feel like we are not recognized by other people. And then you have to totally depend on other people. You have to wear the same thing. You have to, you know, I always say a lot of people cannot live by themselves because they need to have a boyfriend, a girlfriend, come to recognize, okay, if I have a girlfriend, I have a boyfriend, then I'm important. I'm someone who loves me. Why don't you love yourself first? Yeah, really, you got to love yourself first. Yeah. So I think that, you know, and the next week we'll come to recognize this, you know, the inside, the inner wealth. And I think that for the happiness, you really not totally count on the outside material. And you can really live a, you know, kind of content. I think that's also, you know, if we kind of control about our desire, I think this whole world getting better. It's always the desire driven, you know, for the crisis of on this earth. The other thing is I also listed here about Buddhism and forests. Very interesting when they come to the environmental issue, they talk about the tree and the Buddha. In there was some kind of symbol. The first one, very interesting, the Buddha attained under the Bodhi tree, and the Buddha died at the Sara. There was two trees. He died, you know, when he died, he entered the Palandemana, was depleted. It was on, you know, between the two, they call Sala, Sala, you know, Salosu, you know, the tree's name. So very interesting, you know, it has some kind of symbols here. And then if you look at the, Aranya monks, is in Buddhism, you have two tradition. One is called forest dwelling monks. That's called Aranya monk. It's the people who looking more for salutation and with the nature. And you know what? In the Vinaya, right now, you know, you have all this ordination of the tree and, you know, tree rituals. But in Vinaya, there was a story about, very interesting, you know. Well, the monks, they try to find a place. And so they have to cut down the tree and then have put a hut, a meditation hut. But, you know, the monk was bothered by this, the spirit living on this tree. So he came to kind of bother, you know, kind of annoy, disturb him in the dreams, like protest. And so the monk had to go to tell the Buddha, say, oh, you know, we really need this place, but, you know, the spirit protests, what should we do? And the Buddha said, well, you have to chant this mantra, you know, kind of give a blessing. You know, I think basically negotiation, kind of negotiation, then you can do it. So they also have some the rituals for the tree here. Again, as I mentioned from the beginning, you know, when there are a bunch of monks in Thailand, you know, start this movement about try to save the forest. So they all call, you know, Thai ecology monk. Okay. So I would like you, if you, you know, type in the ecology monks, you probably get a lot of information. It's not just one, but many. And there was all the, like a prayer for the tree or the, you know, ordination of the tree here. Well, that's an interesting question. Yes, I mean, traditional Buddhism, that plants do not include in this, you know, reincarnation field. Only sentient beings. And well, next week we will introduce this, you know, a sixth realm, but you know, also called the ten Dharma realm and include the Bodhisattva. So, no, I mean, in early Buddhism, it's not. However, the later in Mahayana Buddhism, if you read it, it sounds like okay, the rock also knock, you know, kind of understand what the monks are teaching. Or if you see from some a poem, it kind of reveal okay the mountain, the river, you know, all attend the enlightenment. But I think that it's a different interpretation. I don't think it's the rock or the tree itself attend the enlightenment. It's when you are attend the enlightenment, you see include the flower, include the grass, include the plant, include the river, the mountain, attend the enlightenment.